Welcome everyone to a series of talks that I'm doing here with my friend Chris Baish. And we're going to be discussing a subject that we're both really interested in and fascinated by, which is rebirth and all the things that go along with rebirth. You might also call it reincarnation because that's part of the story. And this began really because I read a book by Chris, a wonderful book called LSD and the Mind of the Universe. And what it did is it kind of just triggered a real recognition in me. And since I'm a teacher of spiritual matters and I'm the founder of a system called the Gene Keys, that resonance that went off in me, it caused me to reach out via email to this amazing man. And you never know whether you're going to hear back from in those instances. And Chris very kindly got back to me and we started a series of dialogues and discussions, and we realized that we really enjoyed having dialogues together. So that's why we're here, and we're going to explore this subject in several sessions. So today we're going to just begin with some introductory concepts and basics and then see where it leaves us. So I hope you enjoy it, and I'm very much looking forward to it. So
and we're anticipating three discussions.
Absolutely. Yeah. So Chris, if you want to say a few things about yourself, just so that people know who you are.
It's a pleasure to meet here, and I've enjoyed our conversations that we've had prior to this, and this present dialogue grew out of those earlier conversations. I am a professor of philosophy and religious studies. I'm on the religious studies side of the shop. I'm retired from Youngstown State University. In the course of my teaching, I've taught courses on world religions and Eastern religions and transpersonal psychology of religion and comparative mysticism, Buddhism. So I've been teaching in areas touching on reincarnation for many years. I've written several books. My first one was on reincarnation, starting with the scientific evidence for reincarnation, which we'll be touching on today. And it's been seminal in my thinking. And I just believe that reincarnation is one of those concepts that is like plate tectonics. If you, at first it's hard to see because it's not obvious, but once you see it, it changes everything. It changes so much. It opens up the horizon of existence. So we thought this would be a good topic to have a shared conversation about. And I'm just real pleased to be here.
Great, thanks, Chris. And I mean, I will put the link in afterwards, but there's some great things, talks that you've done, and particularly one which I watched fairly recently about, is there evidence for reincarnation? And it's so illuminating and extraordinary and kind of overlooked by so many people. Tell us some of the, you know, your story in assembling and amassing that, some of that evidence, or meeting the other people that have.
Well, you know, I came from a traditional religious background, but over the course of many years of graduate education, I finished my doctoral work in philosophy of religion as an atheistically inclined agnostic. And basically, I'd studied my way out of religion altogether. So I started my academic career as a young man a long time ago in 1978. And I met there the work of two people in my first year, and both of them changed the course of my life. The first was Ian Stevenson, the Carlson professor at the University of Virginia, whose lifelong work has been to provide carefully documented cases that clearly of young children, small children who have spontaneous memories of their previous life. And then researching these children from all over the world, collecting thousands of cases, publishing hundreds of cases. And he convinced me that reincarnation was a simple fact of life.
And that's quite a book, isn't it? That's a big book he's written.
The book he's written about, I think close to a dozen now, but this first one was called 20 Cases Suggestive of Reincarnation. Yeah. And it was a life pivot. Because reincarnation was never discussed in my graduate education. It was never discussed in the Western religions or in the scientific tradition that had kind of wiped the slate clean for of the religious traditions.
So I just erased my blackboard and began to rethink again the larger questions of life, incorporating reincarnation. The second person I met at that time was Stanislav Grof, who is the foremost authority on integrating psychedelics into psychotherapy. And he was providing a methodology that actually allows one to explore the deeper dimensions of one's own consciousness. So that began a whole nother journey, a second journey, which culminated eventually in the publication of this book Richard mentioned, LSD in the Mind of the Universe. But today, the focus here is on Ian Stevenson's, what he started in the revolution of really providing carefully documented evidence that reincarnation is just simply a fact of life. It's not a religious thing. It's simply a natural phenomenon that's happening in the world.
And in your talk you gave, again, which we'll, the link will be here. As a wonderful years spent as an academic, you kind of argue both sides. So you show how, you know, different people have come in and even written books to refute those things, but how they've fallen short. And so there's this whole story around it. And there's this growing body of evidence that maybe in the last 50 years has been documented. I mean, it's fairly recent, isn't it?
It is recent. 50 years ago, we didn't have this evidence. It was still, reincarnation was a speculative topic that the theologians argued back and forth on. But now it's moved from the theologian's table to the psychologist's table. And now, it's, as we explore more deeply the deeper levels of consciousness in the depth psychology tradition, we just find we're bumping into this evidence over and over again. Now, the Western philosophical tradition, of course, is kind of still saturated with the metaphysical position of naturalism, which says the only thing which is real is that which is physical. So therefore, the brain produces your mind. So obviously, in that system, once your brain dies, your mind ceases to exist. So it's impossible for there to be something like reincarnation, because it implies a dimension of reality that's behind the physical world. If consciousness can exist there for any interval of time between the death of one personality and the birth of a second personality. So naturally, there's been a real pushback from philosophical traditions in the West. Mostly they've just ignored the evidence. They don't look at it. And even those who look at it and engage it, the foremost critic that I mentioned in my talk was a man named Paul Edwards, a substantial American philosopher. Even in his work, the evidence, really a careful, dispassionate analysis of the debate between Ian Stevenson on the one hand and Paul Edwards on the other hand, is that he just refuses to look seriously at the evidence because he's convinced beforehand that the evidence must be somehow faulty because we know that reincarnation can't happen.
Yeah, of course. And that's often the way with academics sometimes, isn't it?
Yeah.
And what, you know, a great, you know, so that's like, that's really interesting in itself, just the evidence. And I don't think we need to kind of go any more into that now, but it's like, what are the implications, you know, if we do, because this year I've done a series of videos myself, short ones, just exploring the implications of what if I say yes to this concept and I explore it, and, you know, if I open my mind and my heart to it and I begin to really deeply explore it, you know, the implications to our worldview and the way we move through life is huge, isn't it?
Yeah. It all hinges on time, how much time we have. Yeah. Because if you have a sense of, let me back up. I'm a professor, right? So if I give a quiz in class, I can expect a certain quality of an answer back. If I give an exam that takes an hour, I expect a higher quality of response. And if it's a take-home research paper, I have higher expectations still because they have more time. So philosophically, if we believe we only live on Earth one time, and we only have, in some cases, a few minutes to as many as 100 years, and we extrapolate from that, if there is a purpose to existence, that purpose must be proportionate to the amount of time we have to fulfill that purpose. But if we have 100 lifetimes, 1,000 lifetimes in which to actualize the purpose of the universe, then I think it expands exponentially our potential assessment of what the purpose of existence might be. And that's why it's such an important philosophical discussion, because once you understand the dynamics of reincarnation, once you grasp the fundamental principle, then it lifts the constriction of time. And it allows us to begin to think in terms of and appreciate and understand the larger patterns of the pulse of cause and effect overarching over centuries of time. And it just elevates the whole discussion.
Absolutely. And I think, like, you know, if I can be blunt, like, if you have an inherent sense of a divinity behind creation, mm-hmm. then it seems logical to extend that into, if you know, that this concept of generosity, because mm-hmm. if you had a divinity and you only have one life, it's very stingy, it seems. It would seem like it doesn't seem to have any kind of pattern or reason to it. You know, yeah. It's like, for me, life is just, you know, spirit is just filled with generosity and in terms of time and if we kind of open to the eternal nature of life, then of course that would make sense, you know, for there to be a continuity of consciousness. And mm-hmm. I think that, you know, the more people open to this, the more they kind of realize it has some deep root inside them, you know. And I've you know, I discovered that a lot because I've begun to talk about it more and more. And yeah. one of the things I realize is no one else is really much, other than people who are doing past life regression therapeutically, a lot of the teachers and spiritual teachers in the world today avoid this subject. I don't know if they consciously avoid it, but they don't talk about it. I mean, they get asked questions, but then their answers are kind of generally quite short and it doesn't get picked up. And I'm really interested in something that is passed over, that is so obvious, and it should be in plain view for all of us.
Isn't that curious? I mean, I understand why my colleagues at the university, who tend to be, you know, materialists and reductionists, why
that they I understand
talk about it. But why spiritual teachers wouldn't talk about it, or wouldn't use it to sort of frame a larger, an expanded horizon. You know, sometimes I've heard people say, well, it can dilute your intensity of commitments for realization in the present. Mm-hmm. But, if you think you have many lifetimes, then you're not going to take this lifetime as seriously. But I think that argument kind of evaporates quickly once you look at it carefully. I think it deepens the textures of the situations in which we find ourselves in. And let me just give you one example. Some of the research, Michael Newton's research, for example, in his book, Journeys of the Soul and Destiny of Souls, he and other past life therapists have found evidence that we choose our incarnation. Now, I think in some ways, many people don't. They may kind of go very haphazardly and take what's available. But as you get mature, you choose your incarnation carefully. Now, if we choose our incarnation carefully, when there was a time when we knew more than we know now, and we could see more than we could see now, if we chose the life that we're living now, with all of its ups and downs and challenges and opportunities, then doesn't that change how we might relate to those very circumstances in which we find ourselves? You know, not to go chasing all sorts of hidden meanings, but to basically temper the quality of the self-responsibility that we use in how we engage the people that we're with, the circumstances that we find ourselves in.
Yeah, and doesn't it make you also, for me, it makes me feel more like a kind of eternal cosmic adventurer. So it enriches this time I'm in now. It actually, in many ways, it focuses me a lot more into the present, because I'm not worrying about dying, yeah. if you know what I mean. It changes that. And it's not just a concept. You know, you have to go, you know, this is my understanding through my teachings, is you have to contemplate something very deeply like this for it to start to kind of take root in you. And then as it takes root in you, it brings out of your, you know, literally, I feel in, it's the truth of it is in our DNA. It's like it's in us. So yeah. once that gets triggered, that kind of awakening of the memory, it there's a sort of certainty and a stability that grows inside us that enables us to handle whatever challenges come to us in a really much more powerful way, because we're rooted in this kind of eternal acceptance of this, you know, this is like, because you hear it all the time on people on the radio. So I heard last week, like someone just saying, well, yeah, you've only got one life, so you've got to, you know, really make the most of it, which is a great thing to say, but it's also, you only got one life. It's just, I keep coming back to that's really a tight kind of reality from whichever belief system you're operating out of.
Yeah. Cuts the legs right out from under you.
Yeah.
Because correlating with that is usually the ideas of your existence, the universe is being driven by blind chance. It's just random mutation. There's no existential significance to the circumstances in which you find yourself in. So you only get one shot, make the best of it. But then when you die, it's gone. You're gone anyway. So who cares?
Yeah.
And that's just such a demeaning and counterintuitive philosophy of life. Because I think when we look at the beauties of nature, when we look at the night sky, when we see the pictures from the Hubble telescope of the magnificent patterns in the deep cosmos, when we look around us at Earth and look at the depth of the emergence of life and the emergence of self-awareness on the planet over time, all these projects take place over enormous sweeps of time. And we are the first generation to really appreciate how much time the universe has had to be evolving into the form that it is. Now, if the universe and everything it's doing takes enormous amounts of time, and we only have one life, then existentially we're cut off. We don't participate in that massive project. But if we do participate, if we live multiple lifetimes, there's a good news, bad news situation. You know, the bad news is, you know, well, it's hard work in this lifetime and we'd like to have it over with when we die. But if we keep coming back, you know, there's a larger project afoot. You know, it's not a simple grade like we thought it was before. It's a whole university education. The good news is, you're right, it drops away. The fear of death drops away. I mean, it just drops away. The good news is it allows us to envision a deeper, to feel into the deeper currents of life and the deeper projects. And it allows us to begin to think in terms of longer term projects. And I think this is one of the things you see when people take to heart this idea, even without specific knowledge of their former lives. I mean, that's interesting and that can be helpful. But even without that, when you really let that in and you look around you and you realize that every person you're seeing has been here before and will be here again, it just allows you to engage life with so much more meaning and intensity of the process. That, you know, what we are good at are things we have practiced in the past. Things that we are just getting started on are things we'll get better at in the future. And we can think, we have that much time, we can think in terms of that larger landscape.
Yeah, and of course, you know, we're not, you know, there are many great thinkers and philosophers and sages who have come to the same conclusion about rebirth. And, you know, notably among them in the Western, we can talk a little bit about the Eastern views in a minute.
Common in the East, yeah.
But Jung is someone who obviously springs like straight up into the center frame. Yeah. Because he's a bit more contemporary and you know, he's been this pillar of modern psychology and the way in which we now understand the unconscious. And and the collective unconscious and mythology and all these other transformational kind of consciousness views.
But he tended to hide his belief in reincarnation. Yeah. You know, he came to it kind of late in life, and he began to hide it because he had pushed the boundaries so much.
Yeah.
He was concerned about a backlash, but it's there in his work.
And I think that's what happens with a lot of people. I think they go, well, I'm not sure I want to go into that area because it's got a stigma attached to it.
Yeah.
And it really has, isn't it? Because the moment you say the word reincarnation, you've got like there's a whole kind of battery of skeptics coming at you, whether they're coming from Christianity or whether they're coming from, you know, materialist science, you know, or it's like you're really put your head above the parapet.
Yeah. You know, for decades, I was taking students into the literature on reincarnation. And it's like, once you put all that aside and you just look at the cases, you just look at the evidence. I mean, I found 95% of my students were able to overcome all kinds of resistances, both secular and religious resistances, because they're trained in our culture to follow the evidence. Once they saw the evidence and how consistent it was and how it appeared in so many contexts, spontaneous memories, evoked memories, they accepted it. Once they accepted it, it was a life-changing event in many of their lives.
Yeah. Do you have any favorite stories that you remember of those recurrences? Because it's nice.
I have so many. And the one I opened the book with, Life Cycles, the one I start in the opening pages, is the case of a young girl named Romy Cries. And Romy was born to Catholic parents in Iowa. So it's like, it's okay if they want to reincarnate in India, that's their business. But everybody knows Iowan Catholics do not reincarnate. But she had spontaneous memories of having been a man, Joe Williams, in a previous life. She remembers being married. She remembers having three children and their names. She remembered dying in a motorcycle accident, and she had a phobia of motorcycles. Long story short, researchers got to her eventually and brought her to the town where she had remembered living as Joe Williams. And she was able to remember, identify the mother of Joe Williams. She insisted that they pick up blue flowers on the way to the house because she said those are the flowers that she likes. And that turned out to be true. She was able to identify from pictures who the people were in Joe Williams' life, the players of their life. And she developed this deep emotional bond to Joe Williams' mother, who was alive. And his wife, named Sheila, Joe had been married to Sheila. They did have three children. Sheila and Joe were killed in a motorcycle accident. So this goes on and on and on. I've read hundreds of these cases.
There's so many of them, yeah.
So many. These children remember very intimate details of family history. They remember, they know the architecture inside homes that they've never been in. They can walk around a town that they've never been in and they know their way around. They remember the personalities from the previous person's life, and they remember arguments that they had with neighbors and incidents that came up in, like, the time a child when they were having a birthday party for their child, that a neighbor's dog bit one of the children in the party. I mean, very, very things that are just don't make the public news.
Little details. It's the little details, isn't it? There's one I've read I loved. I can't remember exactly, but I remember a reincarnated memory of in a Muslim family, and they took the little girl, or I think it was a little girl, into the family, and the women were there veiled, completely veiled, and she identified from looking at them, from seeing their body language, without seeing their faces or anything, she could name them. And that was like, wow, that's how deep this kind of detail goes. It's fun to explore those things. And I recommend to people that you just take a look at some of the evidence, because it's very, I find it very affirming. You know, it's sort of like, it's difficult to refute that level of detail. And I don't know, you can come up with, I'm sure a good cynic can come up with all kinds of.
Well, here's one for the cynics. This is one of Ian Stevenson's cases. They brought this boy back into the life circumstances of the previous personality. And the wife of the previous personality said, okay, if you're my husband, where did you put the will? After you died, we looked all over for the will. We couldn't find it.
Yeah.
The little boy walks over to a floorboard in the kitchen, picks up a board, reaches down in underneath the floor and pulls up the will.
Wow. Beautiful, isn't it?
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
How many of those cases do you read before you begin to understand this is just happening? It's just part of the rhythm of life.
Totally. It is extraordinary. And also it had, you know, there's a whole load of documentation about marks on the body, isn't there? You know, people have marks on the body that relate to previous events or, you know, I don't think we need to go down that route, but it's another whole area of documentation.
That was Ian Stevenson's last work. And if you do want to go down that area, you can read his 2-volume, 1,000-page book on reincarnation and biology, in which he studies 187 cases with medical documentation.
Really rigorous, isn't it?
Rigorous, very, very rigorous. Mm-hmm. And what we find is that the death wounds, the wounds associated with death in the previous personality show up as birthmarks or scars in the subsequent personality.
Yeah.
So this is suggesting not only does our mind influence subsequent mind, but even our body, our mind's experience in the body can influence the formation of tissue in our subsequent body. And that, of course, just deepens the story.
Absolutely. And that's why I wanted to bring it up, because that's what leads into the therapeutic work, doesn't it? Because if you open to this idea, then, I mean, I'm just thinking of all the people out there who have difficulties, maybe in their health or maybe in their relationships or maybe addictions or, you know, whatever we're facing in life, or just things that you know, that they've complexes that they find really hard to overcome.
Yeah.
And if we understand that those things may have a root in a previous lifetime and that was something unfinished or incomplete, then it can open up a whole therapeutic journey for us. Can it? And that's what this whole therapeutic community has evolved out of this.
The past life therapy community, basically, there are any number of therapists who've said something to the effect of this. If you put someone into a relaxed, inward-focused state, a hypnotic state, but people have a lot of misunderstandings of what hypnosis, but a just relaxed, inward-focused state, and you invite them to go to the source of the problem that they've come to therapy to address, about 35-40% of them will go back to something in their present life. It'll come back to something that happened in their childhood or something in their infancy. But a significant 50-60% of people will go back to something that's rooted in a previous lifetime. And when they consciously remember that previous lifetime and they consciously reappropriate the trauma that they weren't able to fully internalize and address in that lifetime, particularly death circumstances surrounding their death, when they are able to consciously remember and assimilate it into their present consciousness, then consistently, over and over again, underlying psychological problems and even physical problems begin to loosen their grip on us and untie the knots.
Mm.
So just because a greater depth.
Because they have these roots deep in the collective unconscious, you know, and we're going into the collective unconscious to find them and pull them out, or, you know, aren't we? Yeah. So that's.
Well, let's be a little careful here, because collective unconscious in a Jungian kind of usage refers to the unconscious of the entire species.
Mm-hmm.
But so let's maybe call a soul consciousness, which is the collective unconscious of the individual through time.
Yeah. One, I got a good question for you, which is, I have a really dear friend, and he is a a kind of startling intellect. He's in his late 70s now, and really, really intelligent, very spiritual man. And yet he has a difficulty with reincarnation. And we have wonderful discussions around it in the past. And his very sophisticated spiritual intellect, you know, where it goes is, and I think others may come from this direction as well, that's why I'm saying it, is that, you know, you really want, you know, you want to believe it. Everyone wants to believe in the continuity of our existence. Mm-hmm. And yet, you know, the great Advaita teachers or whatever, that, you know, they would talk about the surrender of the individual ego into the higher, you know, into the back into the ocean of being. And that's something that you have to undergo in order to attain liberation. And so there is this very strong spiritual kind of, I think we, you know, we've referred to it as up and out kind of cosmology. Yeah. Where, you know, there we are here to escape this yeah. cycle, this samsaric cycle, and that, you know, so that we can attain this liberation. And we may attain it within this lifetime in a body, or we may attain it, you know, afterwards. Mm-hmm. So that's another whole kind of yeah. interesting area, isn't it?
Yeah, simply because there are cultures who have believed in reincarnation for thousands of years and have developed a certain understanding of it in their culture, doesn't mean that they've got it right. And I think that reincarnation is one of those ideas that simply once we begin to see the evidence, then it begins to deepen a line of inquiry, which I've revised dramatically the understanding I had of reincarnation borrowed from Eastern traditions, Eastern cultures. And one of the traditions has to do with this larger question, where does reincarnation go? Where is it taking us? What's the end game of reincarnation? Yeah. And you're right, all the cultures, all the religions of the Axial Age that came into existence 3,000 to 5,000 years ago, all of them teach a cosmological journey that's an up and out cosmology. So there is a sense that we're trapped here. This is not as good as spiritual reality. We want to develop either in one lifetime, if it's a Christian salvation by grace, you know, or multiple lifetimes to achieve samsara. Achieve moksha, which is escape from samsara, escape from the physical world. We achieve some type of enlightenment condition, which is the passport that allows us to leave and not come back. And all of these traditions are basically about escape. And that leaves unanswered the fundamental question, what is the purpose of physical existence in the first place? And now that we have a deeper understanding of how many billions of years of genius have gone into the manifestation of the physical world, it's not a very satisfactory conclusion to think that just within we only became conscious of this deeper dimensions about 5,000 years ago. As soon as we become self-conscious of the level of consciousness which we share with all other beings and all existence, as soon as we become aware of that and can live our life from that center, then the purpose of existence is to escape the entire physical world. Yeah. And I don't think that's really true.
And it's a little bit rooted in that kind of slightly self-denial philosophy, isn't it? That, you know, that also is many thousands of years old.
Yeah. I think they're basically all the axial religions got two things fundamentally wrong. They got many things right, but they got two things wrong. They got nature wrong. They don't really have an adequate theology or understanding of nature. And they got women wrong. And the two are connected because women are so closely connected to nature. Yeah. And they're patriarchally oriented and they're escapist oriented. And I think it makes, as an historian, I understand it. I think about 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, through various psychotechnologies, either yoga or meditation or psychedelic substances, we began to have a deeper experience of the mother universe, of this universe that surrounds the physical universe. Once you have experiential contact with that universe, it is so blissful, it is so ecstatic soaked that you cannot help, and you recognize that that's where we're from. You cannot help believe that that's where we belong. This is not where we belong. That's where we belong. Okay.
Yeah.
And they develop a theology of return. So the savior comes to take us home. The enlightened being comes to liberate us back into our home. But that still leaves the question, what is the purpose of creation?
Mm.
And I think what we're beginning to understand now, as our experience of this mother universe is deepened over time, and our understanding of the physical universe has deepened over time, is that we're not here to achieve escape velocity and leave. We're here to incarnate more and more and more of spiritual reality and capacity inside our physical being so that we can truly live and create heaven on earth, to wake up and stay.
Yeah.
I mean, not just to wake up as an individual, but to wake up as an entire species. And stay.
Yeah. Now that you can't leave that. I mean, we're going to discuss that more, aren't we?
We're going to come back to that. Yeah.
But that's a huge window to open up.
It is.
It's this, you know, and you've touched on a lot of themes there. Particularly, you know, the thing about the feminine, that, you know, the physical body, you know, like that's what I think I interpret partly what you're saying as well, is that those religions didn't really understand the physical body, as you said, nature.
Yeah. Didn't value.
Because there is, you know, there's vast beauty in this physicality. Mm. And it's, you know, perhaps what we're exploring is perhaps it's here to be spiritualized. Perhaps it's here perhaps that's why we're here, to bring that ecstatic realization deeper and deeper and deeper into the form. Because then, you know, if we see that that's our highest purpose, we no longer want to leave, you know, because that's then our role, is through subsequent incarnations to bring more and more of that light down into the earth, into, you know, to, you know, and then we're also taking full responsibility for the body and the earth, you know, which is something we also haven't done very well.
Yeah, absolutely. And if that sounds at first disappointing, where we would say, oh no, I want heaven, please. Thank you very much. I don't want a transformed body here, because here is still too difficult. I think we may be underestimating what is possible, and just what it would really feel like to live a truly, fully spiritualized, enlightened existence. And here I think we can look at some of the God-soaked masters of history who are truly living in the God-soaked condition, or a primordial condition that is radically open to the vast mind of the universe inside their body, inside time and space. And what we're seeing from these Mahasiddhas, these great beings, is that they can do what we would call miracles, because there is so much spiritual power concentrated in their presence that it is as if the laws of nature operate differently around them. And they're showing us as a prototype of what each of us is in the process of becoming.
Yeah.
You know? And therefore, if we imagine what it would be like to have an entire species kind of living in that kind of presence, and what a planet.
And our physics is also pushing us in that direction, isn't it? To the understandings that we're entangled with nature, with the universe, and that, you know, that my whole teaching is based on this notion that in our DNA are contained these sleeping dormant codes, these cities, as I call them, 64 cities, like you're talking about, they're an activation inside us that is waiting for its moment, so that we can enter more fully into the next phase of our evolution, the magical universe, the quantum universe, you know, where our thoughts and our feelings and our sensations are actually traveling kind of outside our physical body. You know, they're entangled with nature, so nature then responds with us, to us, which perhaps it already does at a level that we're not aware of.
Yes, I think so.
So it's just about opening up those pathways, you know, those literal pathways in our being into that next phase of our evolution.
We are already plugged into nature at very, very deep levels, down to the quantum level in the unified field. We're plugged into our ecosystems and these subtle, intimate feedbacks. We're plugged into each other. Our minds wash back and forth. We're already there. But when we can become conscious of those connections, when we can sort of lift off the obstructive shadows that are carryovers from other sadder times, then that connection becomes begins to rise, and it empowers a conscious participation. And it makes what was unconscious conscious. And then existence becomes more enlivened, I think, and enlivened with the synchronicities that sort of indicate the broader intelligence that's you know, that's alive in life around us.
And I'm sure that, you know, I'd love it if we could bring our conversation also into sort of into people's lives a little bit, so that they can consider their relationships and, you know, from this perspective, and how that might change one's attitudes or views towards difficult relationships, or towards you know, what, you know, what's the afflictions that come up in us and that we have to handle in our everyday life. It really changes all of that, doesn't it? Because it, you know, then you look at life, and it's actually a process of the opening of the heart, you know, which the teachers have always said. It's like every relationship, its purpose is to show us some grace. And I call this law of unseen grace, you know, where every relationship that shows up is offering us some, you know, particularly the difficult ones, is offering us some incredible teaching, some virtue that we haven't yet polished, you know, whether it's forgiveness or whether it's, you know, some, you know, clarity, or whether it's, you know, whatever it is, it's just, it's some form of love that we are here to learn from those relationships, because they come as part of our teaching karma. You know, it's all, I always see like that, you know, the ancients called it this life a lila, and I always see these, a game, a drama, a theater, and it's almost like before you come in, you're given this little envelope, and in there you open up the envelope, and in there is like, okay, here's your script here, and here are the, you know, and there's going to be some things that show up, and these are the things you're going to learn, this, you know, you've chosen it at some level. And so that changes the way that we kind of see it's behave, doesn't it? I'm sure, like, if you had personal experience of that in your life, in your emotional life, I mean, that's
And one more step, it's not simply the envelope that was given you, but you were given three envelopes, and you chose the one that you felt was most suited for your evolution at this particular point in history. And so it's your choice to engage these challenges. And and when we engage our life in that way, as taking full responsibility for the circumstances in which we find ourselves in, it allows us to engage the challenges with more patience and with more dedication and with more of the long term, because we know we're not, if this is something that if we don't deal with it now, it's not going to go away. It's just going to come back in another form. So let's get it done now. Let's deal with it now. And it also allows you to build on things, because I think our understanding of reincarnation is being very informed by the therapist working heroically in past life therapy. But if you only pay attention to those cases, it can tend to create an understanding of reincarnation that is tilted towards failures, which are coming forward.
Traumas.
But just like the school system around us has many faults, but most of the kids learn and most of the kids pass every year. And I think most people rise to the karma, the challenge of their
of their life. And that means every lifetime, we're not simply dealing with leftover issues from the past. We're building on assets. We're spending assets and investing in greater fruition in the future. And so it helps us handle the challenging circumstances, but it also helps us embrace the positive circumstances of our life, the hidden talent, which comes forward unannounced, the partnership, which emerges that we feel such a deep kinship with this person that we can go forward and do something new with.
And I you kind of triggered a memory of mine about from Sri Aurobindo, you know, who spoke incredibly clearly, you know, with his penetrating mind about the complexity of karma and how we, you know, because we need to sort of probably discuss karma a little bit.
Yeah.
And how it, you know, we misunderstand it so easily by trying to oversimplify it. And actually, you know, when you look at the universe with all its multiple dimensions and, you know, the quantum field, and there's these force fields operating at different levels, but there's this karmic force that's equalizing and balancing, you know, or that has a tendency towards balance, we could say, and is in allowing us to go through this educational process. But everything at different levels is influenced by these strands of the karmic force, and that karmic force seems to have, it's like this, the idea I said about unseen grace. Yeah. If you are able to fully embrace it in your life, then you get the grace through going through unwrapping it. But you've got to kind of have the courage to face it fully and really take it in and let it, in, you know, whatever the suffering is, transform it, transmute it. So doesn't transmutation of karma play a huge part in this reincarnative theology? I mean,
if we just look around us, it's the web of cause and effect. Everything is cause and effect. We live in a continuous web of cause and effect. The air we breathe, the weather patterns, our biology, what we ate, the purity of what we ate, everything is this flow of cause and effect. The universe, the movement of the planets, the solar system, we live in a continuous web of cause and effect. And here we're simply focusing on that portion of the web of cause and effect, which influences the human, the development of the soul, influences our human psychophysical development, which is a subset of this much larger cause and effect. And in that context, I think we've had a tendency, I think, to narrow our discussion of karma. Usually many of the teachers will talk about karma, and they're only talking about that portion of the karma which immediately impinges upon our spiritual maturity, whether we're making progress, becoming a more spiritually mature person. But a lot of karma, probably the bulk of karma, is just amoral cause and effect. You have a habit, you practice something, it becomes a skill. That skill carries over into another life. You have an automobile accident, you develop a trauma of a particular circumstance that carries over into another life. It's not necessarily about your spiritual development. It's just cause and effect.
Yeah. Circumstantial.
Yeah. And so as you open up to the conditioning that's kind of etching itself in your life and you lift it out, you engage it, lift it out, then that the wellspring of your life becomes freer. It becomes clearer, and you're not stepping out of the web of cause and effect, but you're stepping into a greater freedom within the web work of cause and effect that surrounds you. You have greater capacity to make increasingly free choices, greater capacity to choose. Ask yourself, well, what do I want? What would I like to have, instead of a compulsion of you know, grabbing.
You know, it's tempting, isn't it, for some people to kind of say, well, karma and reincarnation, you know, and then there's this story of like, well, that person over there was born disabled. Does that mean they've done something terrible in their last life? And there's that whole real sort of oversimplification of a very complex kind of arena where, you know, we don't, unless you can plug right into the soul quality inside that person, inside that being, you don't really know, you know, what, you know, they could be that hidden saint that has deliberately taken on that incredibly challenging role to polish one particular virtue, you know, or skill, you know, like over the period of one lifetime. And equally, I guess, like very short incarnations, that's, I don't think you and I talked about those, but I'd love to hear what you said, you know, like a child that comes in for a very short time and then leaves. That also has implications for the healing of the whole, doesn't it? Because why does a child come in for a short time, or a baby is born very, you know, for a very short period of time, and then there's leaves this grief behind it, but then there's this feeling that it's also still part of your life. Let's explore that. I mean, we haven't, we can go on.
We talked about that.
You
know, it's, we can recognize the principle of cause and effect. We can recognize the principle of karma vipaka, cause and effect. But then we can get, so many teachers, I think, sometimes get, or all of us, we think we can determine cause and effect. We think we can understand it, when really we're just touching the wrapping on the on the package. We're just really touching the surface. Mm-hmm. And the safest position, I think, really is to recognize that we're looking at a deep, deep mystery here. And it would be foolish to try to judge anybody's karma. Yeah. That's just that's a wasted exercise. Better to stick with the karma that you can penetrate within your own life. And you're right, because we don't know, we really don't know what's happening when we see cause and effect operating around us. I would tell my students, when you see great suffering, you're either seeing a sinner or a saint, and you can never know which it is. So best not to make any judgments at all. And I think there are many hidden saints, many more hidden saints, who are taking on a lot of cause and effect, either from their own larger soul stream or from even a collective soul stream. So they're actually focusing in their body, in their psyche, what we might call negative karma, negative cause and effect, for the uplift of the whole. And that type of generosity and compassion, we see it around us all the time, and good parents and good mothers and good fathers, they would do anything for their children. And I think souls at that deeper level do that too. So we can't judge. We really just shouldn't judge. It's a waste of effort.
No, I read this book. I think I told you about this book. It was, it's a recommendation called Sand Talk. And it's by an Aboriginal from Australia, or part Aboriginal, and really intelligent man. And he tells a story of when he went to talk to one of the elders about, you know, the problems of the indigenous people, particularly the men who had kind of just gone down the role of alcohol, the way of alcoholism, and were eating really terrible food, and like were overweight and obese, and these terrible problems. And he was like really concerned about them. And the old elder just said, yeah, they're the warriors. You know, they are taking on the karmic, you know, they are warrior spirits in our tribe, in our lineage, and they're holding this kind of negativity in their bodies. And, you know, one day they will move from warrior to healer. And that's the path. That's the kind of evolutionary pathway. But it was a beautiful, it really stuck with this young man as he was exploring, like, wow, that's a really kind of powerful, empowering way to see someone dealing with like a cultural problem, you know, or a societal, you know, difficulty that's more collective, you know, that we see a lot. Collective karma is a, you know, we're touching on here as well.
Yeah, it's a very, very deep, those deep currents that run underneath that requires us to open to a much deeper, expanded spiritual story. And because we often think of reincarnation and karma in a very individualistic, atomistic fashion, where we're, you know, the individual soul is involving themselves over the skillful use of choice in the context of karma. And if we start to sink into a larger understanding, a deeper understanding, then we recognize that each individual is a fractal point within a unified field, and that there's these deep currents that are running within the unconscious of humanity, or the soul field of humanity, and that we are all players on a larger evolutionary dynamic, then it just opens up a deeper understanding of what's taking place here. And I know that we've sort of tagged this for one of our topics for our second discussion, but it's, yeah.
Well, yeah. We plant the seed now. The perfect, you know, when you go into that kind of worldview, the perfection of the choreography of what you're explaining is just mind-blowing, isn't it? It's mind-blowing in terms of the interconnectivity of soul groups and these fractals and these patternings of humans. And, you know, and this is why one of the great insights that I got from your Mind of the Universe book, because you described this really well. It's a paradox, I think. And maybe it's one of the last things we can just discuss here today, because it's so important, I find. And it's the paradox of being an individual soul and yet being everything at the same time.
Yeah.
You know, so how does that paradox, how does that hold up? You described it beautifully in your book as, I think you said, the soul the soul was open on all sides. Yeah. I think that was the expression you used, which I really liked, open on all sides.
Yeah.
And it's so like, part of the ocean and yet still a focalized drop.
Yeah.
Diamond awareness also named it.
Yeah, it seems commonsensical that you can't be both a part and the whole at the same time. Those are mutually exclusive categories. And even, you know, great spiritual teachers, the Vedantic tradition in Hinduism and other spiritual systems have said the goal of life is to abandon your individuality, dissolve that, and allow yourself to be absorbed into the totality and to know the bliss of absorption. So that means all the individual capacity which we are developing over all these incarnations in this view ends in extinction.
And it's kind of wasted.
And I think it's wasted. And I think it's an inadequate worldview. And what has emerged in my spiritual path and in my psychedelic path is a very different kind of worldview that I think we share. And that is that we are moving into higher and higher, more sophisticated forms of individuality, that individuality is one of the great gifts of creation. It's something the divine wants to encourage in its creation. Mm-hmm. But at early stages of individuality, we experience our individuality cut off from the larger texture of surrounds. So it's us against them or us and the whole. But when individuality matures into a richer expression, into what I would call the birth of the diamond soul, then there is both a sense of being a specific defined individuality emerging out of a specific historical lineage, and yet at the same time, profoundly open to the larger patterns of existence, open to each other and compassionate heart, open to other human beings with whom we have such deep histories with, and open to, in a sense, the intelligence of the universe, open to the perceptions and the influence of ideas that flow into us, and this communion with the universe. And I actually believe that you have to have developed a very, very strong individuality to withstand the intensity of the communion that's available to us when we enter into communion with the one, with the whole. It is as if we weren't really, really diamond hard and focused and clear, when we encountered the love of the universe for us, it would just shatter us. You know, we have to be strong in order to actually participate in the deeper levels of communion.
Yeah, and I think, you know, that's such an empowering vision. It's so empowering. And it's also I think it opens this question of like our notion of enlightenment, our notion of divinity. We have to kind of go on expanding that, because it's just a notion that we've inherited, you know, and even though, you know, it's been useful to get us to where we are, we have to just go on expanding it. And for me, what is kind of missing more in the current, you know, modalities is creativity, you know, like that, you know, that whole idea of it coming to an end and then going out into the, you know, into the wonderful absorption of the whole, you know, by maintaining the individuality at the same time, what you are maintaining is creativity itself, because then you are like a shard of the divine creative essence. And yes, it's like you say in your book, go out and create, my children, you know. Yeah. And if there were a divinity, let's say, like, and it, you know, and it wanted to have children, then the thing it would want for its children is to be free, right? And to go out and create and to become gods within God. That's the vision I hold, that, you know, we become creator gods within the wider God, you know.
Lovely expression.
In a big G.
Gods within God. Yes. Yeah. The creative spark within the fire of creation. Yeah. Yes. Yes. I agree with that. I share that. And it changes everything. It changes how we greet the children who are born into our families, to, because we know that they're not coming from us, they're coming to us. It changes how we see old people and how we see little people, because young people are not necessarily young in terms of their soul age. Old people are not necessarily old in terms of their soul age. It just opens up a much larger tapestry, and it gives us permission to recognize the deep aspirations that we have towards greatness, towards great creativity, towards the great love, towards great spiritual fulfillment, things that we may or may not finish and get to in this lifetime, but we can move toward them.
It's a much more, in some respect, sophisticated spirituality, isn't it? It's more nuanced. It requires a subtler kind of understanding, I wouldn't say intellectually, but through a subtler intelligence to understand it. It's not this sort of, you know, here's the law of karma, it governs everything, you know, bang. It's not that simple. It's like Aurobindo says, there are layers and layers of understanding and subtlety and nuance. It's like, I'm a lover of tea, you know, fine tea. And, you know, when you find something like that, and you can be anything, you know, you can be a chess player, and you find the subtlest nuances in the thing you're really understanding, the layers and layers and layers, as you become more attuned to it. Yeah. And I think that's what we are. We are becoming more and more attuned, the more evolved that individual soul essence becomes, then the more subtle we can, the more we can understand, you know, these nuances. Yeah. And then we're kind of, I don't know, that we're really inspired by the empowered as well, by the creative current. I mean, maybe we can leave this to the next one, but people always talk about past lives, and part of my teaching is like, I'm interested in future lives as well. And because when you expand your sense of time broadly enough, you know, really, like, really don't hold back anything, you don't need to just look backwards, you can also remember forwards. And because, you know, there's this feeling that memory has to go back, but memory also for me is like it travels forwards. And that's what we call revelation, you know. So revelations can come backwards and forwards through time into this essence, and this essence can be hugely expanded by those revelations, and more focused than ever in the present, you know, in the beauty of the present moment. So, I think that's the thought I'd like to end on. But is there any, like, do you want to close us off?
That's a really good thought and a good spot to end on.
Okay.
To me, it's the principle of accumulation. is one of the fundamental principles I bring to understanding what's happening in creation, that the universe is accumulating. It's learning. It's a self-learning system. And so we are constantly learning. We can't help but learn. Even if we do a mediocre job in our lifetime, we're still learning in that lifetime. And if we do a better job, we're learning. And as we learn, we activate. In one sense, I think we are learning to be geniuses in every area of life. A genius at chess, a genius at relationships, a genius in all the different areas of life. And as if each lifetime is a petal in a flower, the soul is the flower. And I meditate sometimes on a flower and imagine each 100-year lifetime is a pistil and a stamen and a petal in this magnificent flower. And that's, you know, to be a genius at life, to really to be completely unfolded and taking advantage of the opportunity that we've been given to grow and become more than we've been. And again, so many, even though many cultures have understood reincarnation, I don't think they've grasped it fully. They haven't really seen the full potential of the concept. They've really seen it within an early limitation of it. Mm-hmm. And on the future, we're going to talk about time more, I know, as we go on. Yeah. But let me just leave with a thought that Robert Monroe, the great out-of-body researcher and the founder of the Monroe Institute of Applied Sciences, his book, Far Journeys, Ultimate Journey, he said he reached a point in his explorations out-of-body where he realized that you don't necessarily have to incarnate in the next century, that incarnation isn't necessarily historically linear. Mm-hmm. You could have former lives that were actually lived in future time. So isn't that just like,
I'm gonna have to unpick that one a little bit.
Yeah, that really challenges things. So in addition to intuiting the future, which is not yet, and bringing the not yet into the now, I wonder sometimes whether some of us have sampled that future time and are inculcating that awareness in the now.
Yeah, so, that's what I would call the current of involution as opposed to evolution. You know, it's like there is a spiritual force coming down and there is an evolution, evolving force going up, if you want to do it up and down, but you know, it's like a funnel.
Yeah. Sri Aurobindo, I love you quoting Sri Aurobindo because he's one of my heroes too. And he saw that clearly, and I agree.
Yeah. Great. Well, what a wonderful beginning, Chris.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I look forward to where we go next.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. Take care.
All right. Take care, Richard.